friends in LA. My friends and I got really fucked, so we went and broke into a zoo and ate a fucking penguin.
I think you've got the munchies for penguin, and it's going to drive you crazy until you satisfy it.
Welcome to the second episode of our multi-part series on the Californian ideology today. This is CaliBunga, Tech, Drugs, and Capitalist Soul. Towards the end of the last episode, we were talking about capitalism and depression, and the ways in which some attempts to treat depression have the effect of compounding the problem. Now what you're going to hear first is more from our recordings at the University of California, Irvine. Myself, Alex Hohili, and George Hoar were in California in May 2019, thanks to the School of Humanities there, and in particular, Catherine Liu. As you'll have heard last time, Catherine is the convener of the States of Wellness Project, which is carrying out some really important ideology critique on contemporary notions of health and illness and wellness, and in a broader sense, on rationalization and alienation today. Later on in this episode, you'll hear us chatting with some friends of the podcast in a bar in Hollywood, where we analyzed what the meaning of recreational drug taking is in a world in which everything must be monitored and measured. First, though, here's Catherine Liu on the industrialization of mental health treatment.
It's my suspicion that it was also during the 80s when insurance companies no longer insured against for the talking cure, because psychoanalysis was deemed inefficient. And so when you have this chemicalization of mental illness disorder, they'll say, like, I've been going to see my shrink for 13 years and I'm still depressed. Now I take Prozac and I'm not depressed any longer. And so this whole idea of this discursive intersubjectivity that creates a space of complexity and without an accessible cure fits into this idea of accountability and austerity that become the great watchwords of the next 40 years, and we really live with all the consequences of that, because there was this whole idea, as you were saying before, that people were gaming the insurance industry or something. They were pretending to be ill. They were going to psychoanalysts. But the other thing was that psychoanalysts were seen as being charlatans who were just taking money from insurance companies and patients without any derivative cures. And so even today, the talking cures today are very, very ends-oriented, like CBT. It's all behavior modification, because the talking cure is seen as not really accessible, too expensive. And so everything is very, very goal-oriented, and you get 10 sessions, and you're supposed to resolve this issue. So even psychodynamic psychotherapy is operating under the protocols of the pharmacological industry. So what we've
the fix, the immediate fix, the quick fix,
efficiency, accountability, accessibility, these are all terms that get introduced into mental health protocols.
Absolutely. And I think a lot of this reflects the sort of way in which psychoanalysis and psychodynamic kind of assumptions were essentially purged from the profession of psychiatry with the publication of DSM-3.
Michael Mahoney, who you'll have heard in part one, talking about psychopharmacology and the reconfiguration of mental illness.
Robert Spicer, if you look actually at the directory of personnel behind the DSM-3, it's spearheaded by Robert Spicer, and he appears on every single one of the committees. It's like this is real Soviet kind of presentation that you see there. And his goal was essentially to purge psychoanalysis out of psychiatry, which is really ironic because he got his start as a sort of student of Wilhelm Reich, who's like the quackiest of all quacks in psychoanalysis. And he wanted to engender a turn toward one of Freud's contemporaries, Emil Kraepelin. And the DSM-3 is sort of understood to be a Kraepelinian turn. A lot of it does boil down to this kind of inefficiency, right? That there's an inefficiency of psychoanalysis that's not only time-oriented, but it's inconsistent as well. in its results. So you have this way in which results are becoming the...
Yeah, and it's the whole transformation of temporality under neoliberalism that a lot of people have been writing about. It's all about contraction of time, condensation, time as assessment and measurement, and psychoanalytic explorations of the unconscious are precisely against that. And what you have then is the industrialization of diagnosis when you can have these weird, vague generalizations of that in the DSM that then have these chemical solutions. Because I guess for me, the psychoanalytic problem is one, it's a problem of non-industrialized intersubjectivity that is still based on exchange. And it's based on the craft exchange, and it's based on the particularity of that craft exchange.
So let me actually double back to the question of mood as a way of also broadening it out to the question of capitalism and emotionalism, mood, right? And I think this is one of the really interesting bits that comes out of your paper. I mean, the basic question is, why is mood so important in contemporary capitalism? And we can talk about it in terms of bear and bull markets of consumer confidence. And it's this ineffable thing which drives the economy in a neoliberal period in which seizing control of the commanding heights of the economy, even in a capitalist form, in terms of, you know, Fordism, for example, of Keynesian management of the economy, is taboo. So all you can do is shift around the edges of moods and hope that you encourage the right sort of animal spirits to drive markets forward, because you can't actually say, for example, we're going to have a mass build out of infrastructure or energy of whatever sort of energy as a way of driving forward the economy, even under very capitalist terms, without even talking about, you know, socialist transformation of the economy. And I just wonder how this relates to the question of illness and how people see themselves, that mood is just something that you can touch around the edges of to make things be sort of all right without any substantial transformation in your own personhood or subjectivity or impact on the wider world.
Right, and one of the things I think that's really interesting is that in behavioral economics, mood is a sort of way out of relying on the sort of judgments of individual investors. It becomes an object for talking about certain confidence trends within the market, right? But it's not attached to any one given investor. It's not attached to any one asset. And you see a kind of inversion of this taking place in these advertisements for pharmaceuticals, right? That mood becomes this intensely personal, an intensely private kind of category. But in both cases, I think, you can see mood as this kind of statistical object. It's an abstraction that allows a certain kind of guiding of judgment to take place.
So there's an obsession with mood in contemporary capitalism. And new technologies allow for the measurement of it, as well as for the interventionist treatment of moods. This is clearly a facet of the Californian ideology, that is, technology and well-being. But it's accompanied by an insistence on being efficient, productive, and motivated. And this has a distinct class dynamic behind it, as Catherine explains.
But I also think there's something like really sinister that happens, and I think this happens. This is probably because I'm hailed more as a woman on these kinds of things, where the wellness, the ideology of wellness is a kind of class struggle from the top down. So that every kind of failure in mood, failure in health, is personally attributed to some kind of lack of self-care. Mm-hmm. And it's very feminized, you know, this idea of self-care, but you have this all-encompassing sense of ever hyper-vigilant trying to identify things that are not going right. And this is what Irvine talks about, too. It's part of the protocol of diagnosis now, that every year you go in and you have to get all of these tests. And in her book, you know, on with that very long title, An Epidemic of Wellness, Natural Causes, she says she's going to refuse all tests anymore.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, even that's a really great introduction.
Because the body itself has become this site of constant vigilance to see if there are any disorders. And I think for women, that's always been the way that we've lived. Like, do I, oh my God, I have this flap here, oh my God. You're constantly looking, policing yourself with regard to like an ideal. And now this has been sublated to like becoming a social hypervigilance. But if something goes wrong, it's attributed to your own lack of control your lack of appetites. And I was saying to George before this thing that in the high, you know, robber baron capitalism, the robber barons all had gout and they were fat and ugly and unhealthy, and they watched, you know, young athletic African Americans and Irish boxers box because they were so beautiful and in shape because they were always doing physical labor and they were not eating very well. Today we have like the capitalist who's super slim, Silicon Valley fit, and the workers are having the working class is having corn syrup basically piped in to their bodies because of the poor diet and corn syrup and salt. So we have the monopolization of good health in the hands of the elites, and anyone who fails to achieve, there's a generalization of feminine hypervigilance. Anyone who fails to achieve wellness is, you know, morally iniquitous and failing, and just failing existentially. And so you can really feel like the working class are just failures at wellness, and wellness is like this very sharp and pointy instrument that's being used to fight against like a different way of being.
It's really surprising how much information we collect on ourselves about our mental and physical health, and how happy we are often to share it, or how unwittingly we share it. I mean, a friend of mine has basically something that is against his diaphragm, and it tells him when he's.
Biofeedback.
So it's connected to his phone, which is connected to his phone.
Those professional athletes have that band.
Yeah, because he suffers from anxiety. So the idea would be that if he's feeling anxious, his diaphragm tightens up, and then he gets a notification to relax. So
that would make me really anxious.
Yeah, I know.
nothing like being told you must relax right now to make you really relax.
Relax, or we're gonna shock you with the spell.
Yeah, basically you're being shocked every time you're stressed. You're being like physically shocked, and that's supposed to relax you. But I mean,
the wearable medical instrument. Well, that's all.
But you're invited or very strongly suggested that you should engage in this yourself if you want to be well. And who doesn't want to be well? Because if you're not well, then you're a moral as well as an economic failure.
But it also seems like how this runs contrary to something which it seems to be related to, which is, you know, the whole person, the holistic treatment of the person, which seems a bit new agey.
Yeah.
And this is the treatment of the whole person as if it were a car or some sort of machine, which all component parts can be tested and analyzed and evaluated and monitored the whole time to make sure that it is in the best form and function to be able to drive in a single direction, i.e. to be productive, right? Because your whole body and mind is being driven towards economic productivity.
But I also think that human beings need care. This goes back to Winnicott and my like deeply romantic view of care. But this, rather than having your friend go to the doctor once a week, right? That's too expensive. We have this self-care, which is auto-surveillance, be a more efficient way for him to regulate his symptoms. Like in a society where we'd have adequate medical care, people would feel cared for by their doctors.
There's a shop in the Irvine Spectrum.
Mall.
Yeah, it's this big giant outdoor mall owned by the Irvine Company. But there's a store there that serves as a kind of proxy doctor that really plays into this kind of datification of like personal habit as a metric for kind of analyzing health. I can't think of what it's called off the top of my head.
I'll go look at it
this weekend and then report back.
This is the whole Theranos story.
Theranos, right?
Which is like this dream that you can just be testing your blood at home and cool, like I can get these instant results.
And what's really interesting about this is that this is certainly the logic of Silicon Valley's kind of alternative health products, right? They're producing these kind of products that ultimately depend on your kind of phone helping you keep track of your own habits and behaviors. But internal to Silicon Valley, there's this kind of hostility toward the pharmaceutical industry, right? People at Silicon Valley who work in these big tech companies aren't known for kind of consuming like pharmaceuticals in the name of productivity. Their big thing is LSD microdosing, so taking small amounts of LSD to sort of enhance your focus and enhance your productivity. And there's also this kind of big trend of importing what are are actually kind of drugs that exist in Eastern Europe and Russia that are known as nootropics. And nootropics are designed to kind of enhance your brain functioning, promote like whatever Barbara Ehrenreich talks about, these kind of dubious claims about synaptogenesis or neuroplasticity. But they're doing this as an alternative to the pharmaceutical products that exist in the United States. And these Russian medications can be very cheaply imported into the U.S. And they don't fall under any kind of FDA.
So, that's self-medication. Like, I'm my own doctor.
Yes. Yeah. But it's in the name of kind of being able to stay up and code for 3 days without sleep.
One thing we didn't really talk about in the discussion, which often comes in as a key area for the debate over wellness or the claims made for why you should optimize and be as productive as possible, is the brain. We now apparently know so much about it, and nootropics are a really good example, that it doesn't make sense not to optimize. It doesn't make sense not to game it. We know all these things that we didn't know, so we actually have more opportunity to solve social problems, and it's almost irresponsible if you don't meditate, if you don't microdose LSD, if you don't do all the physical
enhancements,
and exercise and all these sorts of things. So it's, I mean, yeah, we don't necessarily have to touch on it here, but I think it's a key site, isn't it?
You can
we know about the brain, so this is a tool for us to optimize.
And you can see this kind of disconnect internal to Silicon Valley too, because the big VCs and the big CEOs aren't the ones that are kind of like trying to enhance their brain through things like nootropics and LSD microdosing. They're the ones that are kind of sponsoring these kind of fad alternative diets,
right?
And promoting the idea that they're developing a means for immortality, right? We want to live with Peter Thiel for the rest of time.
The
singularity. In space, frozen and then unfrozen, dug out.
No, it's the aspirational, the second-tier entrepreneur who's trying to bounce up into the top tier. So, who needs to perform that exploit? He's like dosing himself, and I know it's insane.
But there's also something. I mean, to be critical about this, because I mean, obviously, I'm sympathetic to. I'm a big supporter of the demand for universal health care in the U.S., and that seems to be the pat sort of socialist answer to these things. That if you had public provision of health care, you wouldn't have all this other stuff, right? And yes, there's a degree to which it would undercut it, and it would undercut a lot. But it's important to remember that a lot of these, the drive for wellness, the constant monitoring, the privatization of health concerns, the constant entrance of health and thinking about health and your own personal wellness in your day-to-day life, rather than something which is an occasional illness, is something that happens in Europe as well. It happens in places where there is much greater public provision of healthcare. So, yes, it would help, right? It would help if you had Medicare for all in the U.S., but it's not entirely going to take this away because there's something that is driving this which goes beyond just the absence of the public option or whatever.
I mean, to make a kind of big Vatic claim, I guess, I think part of my project is really interested in trying to demonstrate the idea that the pharmaceutical industry is a culture industry. And that these kind of ads kind of foster into these kind of like public perceptions of health that are not going to get kind of cleared up by just expanding healthcare.
In fact, you can argue, you can go even further and say the problem, in the UK where you have the NHS, which is the most kind of wide-reaching public provision, because, in Germany, whatever, you'll still have insurance, but it's public insurance, right? In the UK, most medical services are free at the point of service. Which is a wonderful thing because it's completely decommodified, at least in terms of the patient and health institution experience, right? That interface is like, I've got a problem, you go in and it's treated and that's it. But because that is because it's then seen as a recourse of last resort, like if I'm ill, but what happens before I get ill? And this is, the UK, there's a lot of promotion of preventative health. And so that brings the whole interface of health into your private life well before you start getting ill and have to go to the doctor.
I think this is one of the things that Silicon Valley is trying to capitalize too, right? This notion of preventative care.
Disrupt even the national health.
Yeah, well, they're the ones providing the preventative care, right? Like, I think that's kind of how they see themselves, because preventative care has really kind of like sunk in terms of pharmaceutical industry interests, because they want kind of chronic illness. They want the idea of chronic illness. They want a sort of continuous consumption of their products.
Mm-hmm.
the historical justification of capitalism.
The UK is not, it has NHS, but it's not the socialist utopia.
Oh, no, of course. No, exactly.
But I do feel like there's just the lack, in the United States, if I can, you know, if we can talk about this, well, this is like the most uncaring society you can imagine right now. Like, we used to think it was third world countries or countries in development where inequality is so, I'm just going to make this big statement. So people are looking for ways of producing care, caring relations, and it's so ironic that all of this preventative care is called self-care. Because it's back to auto surveillance. It's like,
no one else is going to care for you.
You're the only person who's going to be able to care for yourself. And if you end up going to the doctor, you're bankrupt. So it's really like dire. I do think in the UK there is a bit of that sense still, because you know you don't know what will happen with that doctor. There are limitations of the medical establishment, and if you fail in self-care, because it's also an uncaring society, then you just end up being left behind.
Absolutely. And I think it's a lot of this responds to a very real need, an absence of community, an absence of caring relationships, and a movement to the individual, which Christopher Lasher has already talks about in the cultural narcissism.
I know I sound very sentimental, but you need a robust collective culture of sentimentality and mutual care that's not reified. Yeah. And in the absence of that, like, all we have recourse is to these kind of like completely goofy self-care regimes that I feel like really victimize, because that advice industry and all that victimize the most vulnerable people.
Now, if you'll bear with us, we're going to take things to a slightly higher level of abstraction. This whole discussion of mood does raise the question as to whether society, in the absence of any utopian visions of a better future, finds itself depressed. And whether the acceleration of time and technological innovation can leave us feeling more stuck than ever. Here's George, and responding to him is Thomas Williams, whose paper No Revolution is Possible, Depression and the Never-Ending Story of Capitalism, you'll have heard a bit about in part one.
I guess one question which I had reading the paper and thinking about this stuff more generally anyway is, does this situation that you sketch out where potentially there are these obstacles around the mobilization, the depressed person is then frozen, inactive, paralyzed by its very nature, while trapped in the depressive temporality they cannot be mobilized. So there's this idea, maybe this is a political impasse. Does this feel like, does it feel quite dated now? Is this prior to 2016? Is this in the end of history, and now we've had the end of history, as some people like to frame it, and now we move on to something else. People are there's a different affect, and now people are angry. Do you sense this shift?
I see that. I would want to wait for slightly long. I would probably want to wait for slightly longer to see whether, see the extent to which this kind of shift or movement that you talked about, one, like how long it lasts. One is to say that, like, I'm not necessarily sure how long the particular form the particular thing that I've mentioned there is necessarily going to last too. I mean, this is part of the problem, I suppose, of trying to diagnose the present, right? Is that we're too close to it to actually see what the kind of larger scale changes actually are, and how significant what is happening now is actually happening. I mean, there's obviously the possibility that whether this is necessarily a sufficient index of like political change is something, but whether Corbyn and Sanders both get, if Joe Biden wins the nomination, right, and the Conservatives put in Boris Johnson, then he wins by a landslide. What happens?
Yeah.
What happens? And I mean, even that is a transformation at a level of not, which isn't the kind of structural transformation that I'm kind of interested in anyway, to be
yeah.
To, and I don't. I also don't know the extent to which. No,
that's fair. I think we want to. It'd be good to explore this further because we can draw an analogy between economic cycles, so that, for example, post crisis, you have a resumption of, you know, as now it's become a cliched phrase. At the time, it was a bit like, oh, that's interesting, but you know, the new normal.
Yeah.
That you have a resumption at a lower level of profitability.
Yeah.
But the economy kind of stabilizes. And you have that as well as, you know, that after a crisis, things that a new order is established with a different configuration and relation between labor and capital. So labor is weakened once again at lower wage levels.
Mm.
There's wage repression, but things kind of resume again. But profit rates are lower.
Yeah.
And maybe the same thing happens at an effective level, I guess. Uh-huh. And I'm kind of hypothesizing here. But
yeah.
that one has the kind of depressive hedonia, as Mark Fisher referred
yeah.
to it as, in the kind of end of history period, that you have these very serious, turbulent disturbances to the neoliberal order,
uh-huh.
but which then is able to restabilize around a different configuration, which is maybe a little bit more nationalist, a little bit more nakedly authoritarian. At an effective level, maybe people are a little bit angrier and you lash out a bit more, but that it also doesn't find political expression. So maybe you enter an age of, I mean, here I'm really just spitballing, but you know, an age of riots, for example,
yeah.
but completely uncoordinated, unpolitically mediated forms, expressions of anger, but which also are still very much stuck in the self. They're still stuck in a kind of narcissistic age of focus on the self without any building of collective bonds or new organizations which are able to transfer people's affect into actual praxis, you know? So that's a depressing thought, and it goes beyond just Sanders not winning or Corbyn not winning, which we have to accept as a possibility, but maybe there's something good driving behind it. We hope. But it's also possible, we have to consider that depressing possibility that we return to the past, but at a different level.
I mean, I think that form of, I mean, the form of adaptation, or the kind of constant transformation, right, that is inherent in this particular economic form is probably the most terrifying, is at least one of the most terrifying things about it.
But I guess it's a point that we have to take these questions of affect seriously, that they're not just like, yeah, but the politics are going to solve it for us.
Yeah.
Because there is a weird form of responsibility aversion there too, even though we're being political and we're like, no, I'm getting involved with the Sanders campaign, I'm getting involved with Bernie or wherever you are politically engaged. But if it's just at that electoral level,
we can see it as a form of therapy.
And that's even, that's even worse. But even just a sense that you're hoping that the politics will resolve a deeper social crisis, I guess.
Yeah.
So I think it's really provocative to talk this way. And I want to continue spitballing, but I think one of the things that happened after 1989, like when we had the golden age of centrism come to the fore, is that the really depressing thing about it, as you note in your paper, is that we are told over and over again that there is no alternative, there is no social transformation, this is the new reality, we all have to adapt to it, we can't hope for anything else. And it lasted a long time, actually, with all of these ebullient bubbles coming up through the new economy in California, because you would be told, like, we in America, at least, that we're so innovative. We launched, you know, Mozilla. We've launched pets.com. People are making money everywhere. And if you aren't doing that, if you don't have like pet.com or shoes.com, then you're just being left behind. But there's this kind of market ebullience. And then crisis after crisis from 2001 to 2008 ensue. There's a kind of, stasis that those crises, disturb, but the normative forces of innovation, entrepreneurialism, narcissistic self-expression, those things last for a really long time. And then we have 2016, which is like some shock to the body politic that's been in this state of contradictory neurotic stasis. I mean, it's like it was like electroshock therapy when the Brexit vote went the way it did, when Trump was elected. And in some sense, if I'm optimistic, then I say that shock therapy is actually going to be therapeutic, because it shakes you out of this kind of depressive normative mode. And when we start thinking about how we can demand a different kind of authenticity or presentation in public spheres. Because the one thing you have to give to Trump is he changed the tone, and here affect theory is important. He changed the very affect of political engagement. He made all of these stuffed shirts, third wares, look as inauthentic, as plastic, as punishing, as authoritarian as they were meant to be. Of course, he offered a kind of different mode of authoritarianism, but I do have to say, effectually, it was liberating on a very primal level. Now, what that will transform into is something we don't know. But I felt like we were in this like Habermasian kind of stasis where we're all supposed to be dissenting, but in a civil way with regard to the falseness of centrism's presumptions, the falseness of liberalism's presumptions. And Trump just put a big kibosh through that whole thing. So I always feel like we need to have that kind of affectual mobilization on the left, but maybe that's not possible. I love Bernie. I do think he insists upon this kind of the policy-oriented nature of what he's doing. But I do feel like the affectual explosion of Trump, the non-normative ways in which he was excessive and campy, and maybe even queer, like he queered the presidency. He queered the Oval Office. You know, it's like the queer dream come
America's
true.
America's first camp president.
He was, like, queer eye for the White House. He has a campy wife. I mean, the whole thing is like a queer eye dream come true. Gilded everything, excessive everything.
You could say he
He's like Liberace. He's like Liberace.
He queered the truth as well through.
He queered the truth. He queered
alternative
the truth.
Facts.
So now, what do we do with this massive destruction? I don't have any solutions, but I just thought this is a different way. Let's think about a different way of periodizing. And
I think that's good. And I mean, it's a move from consensus, Paul. I mean, I like Jacques Rancière on this. But, you know, that is an age of consensus. And what is politics fundamentally at its essential level? It is dissensus, right?
I agree.
Yeah, nice. Good, so we're done here. That's a wrap.
Do we all agree?
We're done.
But Trump introduces a mode of politics which is alien. It's not normative, right? At least by the standards of the previous era. To say, no, fuck you, we don't want this, right? Which was previously only available in the most, I guess, kind of anarchistic declarations of, well, fuck you, I won't do what you tell me to decide something of that
We don't
era,
like technocratic incrementalism. That's like, that was like a basic message. Like, we don't like your, you know, eggheads telling us what the reality is. And
I mean, I suppose this is a return to what we were talking about a couple of minutes ago, but I think perhaps this is only something which has maybe just occurred to me, which is not, I mean, we could also think, you know, the age of riot and the age of depression actually happening at the same moment, right? So you have something like a long crisis, right? Where the crisis is just, it seems long. It's basically like a period in it. Like, it's a period in itself. It's not even like a break in between two things. The like length of time that it actually like continues actually itself like constitutes what we would generally normally like think of as a period. So it seems as though you like almost can't get out of this kind of continual form of like rupture and
Right. And in fact the vulnerability and the atomization that we've already spoken about in relation to how depression flows in, I guess, at a period in which there's people are more atomized, they're not involved in organizations, there's a depoliticization. The acceleration of crises and entering into an age of turbulence, which seems at least politically more fruitful, more potentially productive, more propitious for us, can also be an era in which people feel even more vulnerable. And I guess transforming that into some productive action rather than kind of an abject position in relation to this crazy flux of the modern world, which we can't intrude upon anymore. I think that's the challenge.
Well, what do you do when crisis is normalized then for you, that when you describe that period, then it's the norm, you know, then you have like never ending crisis, and the state of emergency means that you have the lifting of all laws and norms and constitutional crisis. But maybe that's, but to say that that's a period and a rupture between two periods of norms actually is self-contradictory, Thomas, because you, what you're saying is we just, this destabilization is our new norm.
Isn't it though?
Yeah, it could be. But then what is another name for it? If it's like prolonged crisis, then
I'm sorry, I'm looking at this thing from Strake, but he just calls it like a long period of systemic disintegration.
So this is something that I talk about.
On what you think on that street quote, because I love it, so maybe you can tell us a little
bit. So I'll read it out. So it says, before capitalism will go to hell, then it will, for this foreseeable future, hang in limbo, dead or about to die from an overdose of itself, but still very much around, as nobody will have the power to move its decaying body out of the way. Much more likely, we are facing a long period of systemic disintegration, in which social structures become unstable and unreliable, and therefore uninstructive for those living in them. The social order of capitalism will then issue, not in another order, but in disorder or entropy. And then he goes on to quote Gramsci. So he says, the old is dying, but the new cannot be born. And this ushers in an interregnum in which pathological phenomena of the most diverse sort come into existence. So this is in a society devoid of reasonably coherent and minimally stable institutions capable of normalizing the lives of its members. So, I mean, I suppose that's kind of an advocacy by the end for social democracy, right? But then he talks about, you know, the kind of life in this society demands constant improvisation, so substituting strategy for structure. So this is obviously like the last parts of this quote are things that are obviously like already happening. And so you may say that the kind of rest of it has been happening for a while too. So that might be, disorder can last for a long time. That's all. I mean, I think that's all I'm kind of really saying by that, and that can become a normative structure. Just because it's something that repeats itself doesn't mean that it's not in itself like a mode of like crisis, right? Because there's nothing to say how long a crisis lasts. Mm.
So how do you and I might might not be remembering this entirely correctly, but I think David Harvey's analysis of this is basically, it's kind of maybe a little bit different. So he says from post-war period till the early 1970s, the dominant subject that you had there was alienated.
Yeah.
And that could be unpacked in terms of depression.
Yeah.
And then, but then from 73 onwards, this is when you had a real, this compression of space-time. You had basically the flux that even Marx talks about in the Communist Marx and Engels talk about in the Communist Manifesto really comes to the fore. It's extremely accelerated. And so therefore the subject is basically bombarded with information. Mm. So it goes from being from an alienated to a schizophrenic subject. Mm. Is this in conflict with what you're saying? Because it would seem to suggest actually that you're saying, right, this current period of disorder leads to depression rather than a reaction of too much going on.
I suppose the first thing is to say that I don't think alienation goes away in 1973. I think we can I don't know whether necessarily everybody here would agree with me, but I know that a couple of people would. But also that, you know, the alienated social relations are inherent to capitalism, right? This isn't something that like shifts and moves like over its, this is, you know, social relations under capitalism are alienated. So the very fact to say that it ends is to kind of misunderstand this idea of alienation in the first place. Second is to say that if you are to think of whether this is a correct diagnosis, but if you are to think of the prevalence of, you know, again, like medical pathologies like depression and anxiety, which you might associate with the kind of alienated form, they have again, this may be because of diagnoses and these weren't things that were thought about, but they have also skyrocketed too, right? So I think there is a general overemphasis in this kind of work on space-time over like the domination of time, right? Mm-hmm. Because the domination of time is the thing which is actually inherent to like the law of value itself, right? That's what we sell, right? I suppose.
But this question of time is important because it's often not as it seems. I'm a big advocate of thinking about in terms of social acceleration and how fast time moves and how fast time moves in different times and places and the experience of time. But there is an element of that kind of the feeling today that things are speeding up, that things move faster and faster, that the rate of technological change is faster, even though if we can step back and say we know objectively that technological breakthroughs were more frequent and more important in the early 20th century in terms of chemicals, in terms of transportation. Today, you have this whirlwind of innovation, in particular in communications technology more than transportation or other ones. You have this whirlwind of change at the same time that nothing really changes, right? Everything changes, but everything stays the same. It's one way of speaking of that is of frenetic standstill. Which actually relates to depression quite well, and there's talk about the way in which depression is actually a pathology of our times, and it's a pathological reaction to the sense of things being too fast, things of incessant change with no future, right? So that the temporality is a sense of
I talk about this in a bit in the paper in relation to the work of Moishe Postone, the kind of the late Marxist historian, who talks about this thing called the treadmill effect, right? Which is, I can kind of quote this again, but it kind of talks about this this constant transformation, but also this kind of staying the same, right? So the nature of, this kind of change in the nature of social life, involves the unfolding of capital involves the ongoing reconstitution of its own fundamental condition as an unchanging feature of social life. But then he also then goes to say that the kind of historical dynamic of capital itself is, so this is a quote, so characterized by the constant translation of historical time into the framework of the present, which therefore reinforces that present. It reveals capitalism to be a society marked by a temporal duality, an ongoing accelerating flow of history on the one hand, an ongoing conversion of movement of time into another. So basically, everything kind of basically seems eternal and natural. Everything kind of seems eternal and natural, even though appearances change.
This gloomy take does make us wonder what happened to an earlier spirit closely associated with California, that of hedonistic abandon. But even that was superseded by the late 1970s, where you got the seemingly nihilistic punk proclamations of no future. By the 21st century, that idea of no future may have become so taken for granted as to not be visible anymore. So what does that Californian spirit look like today, in an ever more atomized age where the emphasis is on self-care and quick technological solutions, as proposed by Silicon Valley?
What does this culture without a future actually look like? Because there have been some expressions of even in punk, you're like, Sex Pistols, no future. There's this idea that like actually there's a kind of radical turning away from the future, from responsibility,
and it's reclaiming your own objection.
It's kind of cool. That smoking is cool. We all have to accept this. We are in California. Nobody smokes here, but it is cool.
I'm saying I'd smoke. So
well, you really shouldn't. There's a moral critique there. No, but it's like okay, it's because you're showing right. I don't care. On one aspect of it is I don't care about the future. But a serious sort of serious question here. What does this I think you outlined some of the reasons why we might not have the future, but what does this look like culturally?
I think it's a I can see it. So, you know, I do accept and think that at least certain formulations of that is as a kind of a useful form of rebellion, right? I think there's a limit point to that. There's a kind of limit point to the idea of self-negation.
Hey, would you describe it maybe as a sort of a disinvestment from society? And it's a way of trying to get beyond ideology, which ends up only trapped further in ideology, maybe, the kind of punk gesture of no future, which today seems laughable, right? Because it's already commoditized before it even gets uttered. But I think from today's standpoint, you can look at that and go, but that's just disinvesting. That's just going, I'm washing my hands of society.
And the other thing is that, I haven't really thought this through, but I'm not sure if some of these forms of reclamations are much more than an aesthetic choice, right? Because again, like someone who is maybe actually entirely abjected wouldn't necessarily perceive this idea of like reclaiming their own abjection as being something which is in any way like liberatory. Or wouldn't even be able to do that because they wouldn't have the kind of means or capacity to at that point.
So I wanted to say that with punk, you know, there was still enough in the belief in subcultural innovation that even in its most nihilistic, or maybe especially in its most nihilistic, no future sensibilities, there was a sense that you were remaking the world. Mm-hmm. And that you were going to really transform life. So actually, in fact, it was very optimistic. And the few people who were able to make a living out of it made a huge living out of it. Like I just read Patti Smith's biography as well as Kim Gordon's autobiography, two memoirs. Mm-hmm. And it dispersed into the star system. Like millions of people were in their garages playing guitar badly and believing in this kind of liberation, but a few people made a lot of money out of it and were able to actually live and continue to live downtown. Mm-hmm. What I think is really sad about what's happened today is that kind of youthful enjoyment or hedonism or transgression seems so, every path seems so reified. And I feel like what I understand about your youth is that there is less room for experimentation, less room for failure, less room for hedonism, less room for this kind of joyful nihilism that is about world breaking and remaking. I think there are material, you know, reasons for why that is, but maybe the tenured radical like temporality has to do with the enjoyment of those nostalgic moments of useful world-breaking and world-making. And what you guys don't seem to be met up with is like the exhaustion of all of those alternatives at the same time that because of social media and the algorithmic way in which all of you have to make yourselves visible both to the profession and to your peers, is that there's like the full algorithmic datification of your very beings, from your moods to the things that you're eating, to your Instagram photos, to even your like nihilistic attempts to do some kind of world breaking and making and remaking that, you know, recently with SoundCloud emo hip hop being these 16 to 20 year olds are putting out all of this music online that is really, you know, dark and impressive, but a bunch of them have made a lot of money now and they're like dominating the music industry too. So I feel like capitalists so ready to extract value from the culture of no future. And this is it's a legitimate culture. Like every young person should feel like they can make and break the world, but now you have to feel like you can make and break the world and then make a lot of money out of your attempts to make and break the world. I don't know what to say about that even. I just feel like the older generation, the tenured radical, feels very removed from this new discipline regime. And I don't celebrate the schizophrenic in any way. I'm not a Deleuzian, as all of you know, because I feel like that kind of pure reactivity, that kind of thin subjectivity is what we want to render unto you. And I don't know what the alternatives are, but it's bad for youth is not youth anymore. Youth is like a new time for self-exploitation.
I mean, this hit me very starkly here in California, because as marijuana is legal, you can go to shops which are dispensaries. I mean, you guys know this. I'm being kind of glib in the way that I'm saying it. Even like
go to a shop. Right.
No, but right. But I think that the shopping experience, I was in one of these places, which is basically an Apple store of weed. Yeah. And like, I'm just going, this is kind of weird. This is kind of weird because what was weird about it was precisely the lack of enjoyment in it. It was, it was so sterile and so like, hi, we're respectable middle class people, and we're coming to buy weed. And excuse me, shop attendant, could you best advise me as to the correct strain to treat my ailment? You know, and it's sort of medicalized, but also because it's no longer treated under the medical regime, but it's just legal. It's kind of this in between place, and it's like uptight wine buyers being like, "Oh, I'm not sure about the 88 Merlot," and it's "But this sativa strain leaves me a little bit neurotic," the enjoyment of, hey, let's get stoned and get fucked up is just completely not there. And actually would seem totally inappropriate if you were in there like, hey, man, what's going to get me the most fucked up? And they'd be like, that's not the way we do things here. Here's the wellness range of cannabinoid creams. And that's where the enjoyment is. You know, even this enjoyment thing, this hedonistic thing is where you can be like, yeah, fuck it. There's no future. They have this moment of timelessness of being stoned isn't even being stoned anymore. You know,
it's completely quantified. The most important thing is how much you have and what effect it's going to be. So it's very instrumentalized. And I think that is of a piece with as we were talking about before, the wider. So Mark Fisher talks about pre-corporation. Anything which is potentially radical is already seen coming. So Kurt Cobain, for example, they saw him coming. They commercialized it. They kind of instrumentalized it. And then it's like, same with marijuana. Here's something which previously had some tinge of, real rebellion, getting fucked up, breaking the rules. No, you can actually work out how much of various different things there are in it and what the effect is going to be. It's a bit of a sort of depressing conclusion.
So has taking drugs become like really lame? We obviously went to a bar to find out. Here's George and myself, Alex, talking to two friends of the podcast in some Hollywood bar we forgot the name of. The voices you're going to hear now belong to Amber Lee Frost, whom you'll have heard on this podcast before, as well as freelance writer Alex Gendler.
But this is the thing, right, about weed, about marijuana.
Food.
You're going to break it down for us.
It's just break it, yeah. No, it's just, for me...
It's like Joe Rogan now.
No, yeah. I've seen like weird things to do in LA, and I was like just looking. I was like, "Oh, Joe Rogan is on." Like, just enough.
Joe Rogan's on.
Just wow.
He's always on.
We've
gone like 3 hours a day, doesn't he?
Maybe. But it's like growing up, but like as of my, twenties. Like I don't know anyone who smoked weed like in the UK. Like
or yeah, maybe, no, and like, they,
no
one, they do
no, but
a
people
weird
people
time
did hard drugs. Right?
And they do pills
and
shit.
Yeah, pills and coke. But like, weed was like, why are you doing that? Like,
well,
that's
and now
kind of
they
lame.
Have,
that's teenage.
They now they have a weed that is like a hard drug there.
Yeah.
Where it's
they
like,
have,
oh my
British
God
people have no chill.
They cannot calm down.
Yeah.
It's like they can't even drink. They have to binge drink.
Yeah, that might be right. Yeah.
Their drug culture, they looked at weed, a drug that made you sort of calm down and relax and mellow out and feel like sleekly social. Yeah. And they're like, let's turn it into something that makes you see God. Like,
Well, but so there is no... The only kind of weed consumption that happens is kind of
subcultural,
right? So it's like those people who are into weed, so you're like slightly hippie-ish or slightly... Rasta, or you're slightly, you're basically right.
Guy who was involved in the Labor Party who would not leave me alone about trying to like fucking like smoke weed with him, and I'm like,
why is that?
Why are you like that? And I asked my friend. He goes, oh, he's like, because no one smokes weed here, and he thinks you're American, and like
well,
we
you
do
are
smoke
American
weed, but he's like, he thinks because you're American,
right?
You just like get. And I've talked about smoking weed on the show, but I was like, nope,
this is that terrifying British weed that, like, you know, but makes you
right. But the flip side to that, like in terms of the American experience, is precisely that it's become. I don't know. It's weird for me because it's like, oh wow, this isn't like teenagers, you know, trying to get high and whatever and just acting silly. It's like, I'm gonna go into a shop and consume buy weed like I would.
Coffee.
There's a certain connoisseurship,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
you're
yeah.
Like, okay, so it's sativa strain, da 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 da.
Yeah, no,
like,
bud,
oh, can you advise me on what the, you know?
They're called bud tenders.
Right. Bud
tenders.
Okay.
Bud tenders.
That's fuck a... that portmanteau. But
I mean, honestly, I just like getting high. I think weed nerds are fucking virgins. Like, I don't understand.
Well, right, that was my.
I'm trying to
you
tell
know.
You about. Okay, so here's
but
the. And I'm like.
But that's the one thing that you're not really allowed to do, or to want to do, is just to get fucked up. You can't just want to get high.
No, I love.
There has to be. There has to be. But there has to be an instrumentality to it.
Yeah,
these rules don't apply.
It has to be a form of speaking
yeah,
consumption.
Yeah.
I know. I'm disagreeing with ideology as if he was telling
yeah,
me.
Yeah.
To, he was telling me to subscribe to it.
Yeah, or like
because
when
I'm high.
When people disagree with like it's generalization, it's like it's a generalization. It doesn't apply to everyone all the time. Like, calm down. This is generalization.
Yeah, that's what I really believe.
Yeah. That what the.
No. Yeah. So then that's why it's all quantified, and it's like going into an apple.
Which I guess is fine because it's, you know, it is just alcohol is a drug and it's another drug like that, and I guess that's fine. I
yeah,
guess
but
it's
I don't
just...
like those motherfuckers either who get really into like. I don't like beer nerds either.
Right.
Not to be confused with the beer nerd who is a friend of ours. Who I think only drinks Blue Moon, but
that is a cool beer nerd.
My brother's a beer nerd. He's a brewer even, so it's like next
no,
level. But
he's
like,
a brewer,
right? So
not this. So like, okay, right. This is a professional thing.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It would be
he's
weird,
a,
if
but he
knew
had to,
someone,
but he had to be a beer nerd to get into the
like,
position.
Okay,
yeah.
It would be weird if you knew someone who knew the basics of cat anatomy. But didn't have a veterinary degree, right?
Right.
So people who aren't brewers, who are into beer, I'm like, what are you doing with that beer?
Or just
beer?
Really into cat paraphernalia, but don't have cat.
Yeah.
Like, don't have a cat.
Oh,
just
yeah,
are
yeah,
like,
yeah.
Just like, I'm really, like, I'm the cat. You're a cat fan. But it's like, oh, so how many cats do you have? Oh, no, none. I
yeah. Yeah. They're posers is what we're saying.
Yeah, right, right. Exactly.
It's
a
bit sinister.
For that. Yeah.
It's surprising how many numbers are now associated with having a beer. Obviously, how much you get and how much it costs. But now, the ABV,
yeah.
The IBU. You know,
the
specific
yeah.
Gravity.
Yeah, yeah, that's right as well.
Yeah, so you need to have. I mean, surely it's just a type
oh my
of
God,
beer,
they're turning
and it's
beer
a standard stem. Amount.
That's so
yeah,
I mean, and you know, I like.
Well,
I like
I do have a good friend in Vienna who is a chemistry grad student and runs a brewery, and they let them use the. They let them use the school's like chemistry lab to do all their brewing and stuff. I don't know. It's pretty cool.
I mean, look,
I
like good. I like good. I'm a bon vivant.
I mean,
I like good things.
Nerd.
You know,
yeah,
I like
nice. Things.
But beer is also one of these things which is meant to be consumed while you're doing something more interesting, like
right.
Talking to your friends or whatever, right?
And
you
agree, drinking beer is the more interesting.
But you know, beer geeks. The conversation revolves around the beer, which is a bit like wine geeks, and it's also bad when it's like. It's just a slobbering over, like, no, but the 83 Merlot is just the, you know, and you're
yeah,
like,
no, it's disgusting. You're that guy. And they specifically got into being beer in that way to, like, be that guy, be
yeah.
The wine guy, blah, 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 blah. But that's too out of date. That's anachronistic. But they are exactly that guy.
But then there's a thing about weed, right, where it's like, so that same thing is happening,
beer
right?
That guy
the same,
too.
It's the same thing. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But if this is the generalized.
Both the beer and the wine guy.
But if this is the generalized middle-class experience of consuming weed or, you know, marijuana products that get
yeah.
You high, then, I don't know, then that's one kind of strange, and two, like, then you think, okay, but what's the effect of the drug? It's just, I don't know, there's this element that you can just, I'm not, I don't know, I haven't got my mind.
Are you becoming more on drugs?
I'm pro-alcohol and I'm anti-weed is kind of what I'm... Maybe getting at, I don't know if that...
Most people are, yeah.
Not that I'm, like...
No, you're talking about the masturbation.
I mean,
it's that, it's
okay.
That, because it's a thing of, like, going through your regular day, and you can go through highways.
Yeah, yeah,
like,
yeah.
I'm not going through my day
yeah,
drinking,
you're not getting
like,
fucked
I'm an
up.
Alcoholic then, because
yeah, yeah.
It's like,
yeah,
that's
yeah.
Crazy.
Here's the other thing,
so,
that, I think that touches on this thing of drugs as self-medication under, like, capitalism.
Yeah.
And, like, this idea, like...
Well, and people get to do that and feel like, well, I don't have an opioid addiction.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, but I mean, it's not just that. I mean,
and also,
like,
I don't have emotional difficulties with people because I'm not really feeling anything.
Well, yeah, stuff like weed or psychedelics or even like benzos or whatever, and the fact that like it's not like, like you said, like teenagers getting fucked up to have fun and have like a totally abnormal experience. It's like, oh, this is part of my day. I come home and smoke a bowl and like, you know, pop some pills, or even like before they have to like go out to the store or something.
Yeah.
It's just like, it's like, it's something they do, like, to get through the day.
It's like lubricating. Like, and so like we take this out of British people, like lubricating every social interaction with alcohol because you can't interact without it. I'm actually okay with that. But weed is like,
but
just
also,
in the beginning,
you're all doing it
together.
Yeah.
You're
thing.
Doing
it's
together.
It is a social lubricant.
Yeah.
Yeah,
whereas weed
social.
Isn't. Whereas weed is just like you yourself kind of.
I think
see,
there's
I mean, this is also one of the things that I realize I am a project stoner.
A what stoner?
A project stoner.
Okay.
So I'm like, hey guys,
let's
go let's to a
do
park.
This and
yeah,
do
yeah.
yeah.
Okay. And that's not how most people experience weed.
I think it's because it's part of a general, kind of wider general trend of just managing your hedonism completely. It's like, okay, I can't go beyond this point. Like, I need it to self-medicate. I need it to release just enough without having getting completely fucked up. So I need to be able to go back to work on Monday. But in order to do that, there's a friend of mine who's very into his raving. I was telling you about.
Yeah, I was going
to. He also microdoses LSD and all this sort of stuff. But he's like, okay, well, you need to take this pill at this time and this pill at this time. And before that, you need to have taken all these
optimization.
It's
optimization.
Fat soluble vitamin C because that reduces the come down, and then afterwards you need. And so he's going on a night out with him. It's taking all of these things at a certain point in time.
Cool wants to.
It's kind of cool, but where's the like cutting loose? Where's the actual?
It's a very neoliberalization.
Well, it's like your schedule, like everything.
Yeah. Isn't the whole point of doing drugs also to like disrupt ritual and like, you know, do something sort of different?
Maybe, but there's drugs have had their own rituals as well,
right?
For ages, right? It's like, oh, you know.
Yeah, but not the way I do them.
No, but everybody has, you know, like,
well,
certainly as a teenager, you start thinking
it's a ritual.
Like, how you rid the ritual of like rolling the joint and passing it around.
Yeah,
like, there's certain codes and rules about how you do it and
that's
whatever.
That's organic social stuff.
You're not talking about
like ayahuasca nerdy.
No, okay, no, I'm not. But there's rituals just in
the
banal sense.
Pass,
like of,
pass
no,
the coochie,
that's
pass
fine.
The coochie to the left hand side. Right.
Right.
But yeah. But no, it's like those aren't what I'm talking about. I'm talking about like the idea of like they're taking it when you're scheduling it in that way.
Yeah.
More into the realm of like a hyper ritualized thing.
Yeah.
Not like something that just happens out of like.
Oh, it's
de-ritualized
because it's not. There's no. The whole point of a ritual is it's sort of like conventions that are sort of arbitrarily defined and like. Only
right,
sustained
right.
by the shared community.
This
like,
optimization can not be ritual.
Yeah.
Right.
This is just like,
right.
oh, we take this at this time. It's completely, you know, capitalist.
Well,
but
you can even imagine
a
consultant or a coach of some sort saying, let me optimize your drug taking for you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'm going to measure your, you know, levels of serotonin and whatever else and equilibrate your thing.
Yeah, that's the opposite of ritual.
Like sex.
Huh?
It's completely rationalized, right?
Yeah.
So there's no element
and there's
of
no spontaneous,
the irrational or the spontaneous, which means that you do get more bang for your buck in one very, very narrow sense. And if you're, you know, I'm not defending it, but it fits in better with other things that people have to do.
Well,
and that's
right.
a real shame. That's a real shame.
It is
that
a shame,
that you don't have any ability to be irrational.
Well, I mean, if I could guarantee completely unhinged hedonism for a definite period of time, and then I could be like ready to go to work the next day. It's I can get fucked up on a Tuesday.
That's the paradox. That's the paradox because it is never completely unhinged hedonism if you already have in mind that
it's
there's
gonna,
this
narrow
window within which
true
hedonism would be like throwing out whatever your alarm
because,
clock
because,
or
because
whatever
the, because
set
the three-day bender where you just fucking disappear, like it's not happening.
And you fundamentally can't optimize hedonism just the way you can't optimize ritual.
There we go.
Because you have to fit to be truly unhinged.
That's some good work here.
There has to be
We're making some points.
We're making some progress.
Yeah, because there has to be a possibility of not coming back if it's really unhinged.
It's untethered.
And that's
There's no. Quite
which just sounds, sounds frightening to me. Like, you know, ask me 10 years
that's
ago. I'm like, oh, that sounds great. I'm like, that sounds frightening. No, I don't.
I know you're getting old, man.
Ask me on Sunday afternoon, and I would have been like, no way.
We need to reassess what reality is here. I'm just.
What were you thinking it was? What was the what were your concerns? I love it when people try and recount where their head was when it happened.
So basically, all of the facts of reality, I mean, I could establish them in a fairly logical way. Like, we're in California, we were in LA, mm-hmm. you know, that this is what happened. But they didn't have any, they didn't ring true as I thought them. I was like, this intellectually, I see where it makes sense, but it doesn't have that feel of reality. And so I was
isn't
like,
that
oh.
the psychological phenomenon of derealization?
Is that actually a real
yes.
thing?
Yes. Yeah. Well, you can also have depersonalization where you're like, you're talking and I know you're there, but you're not real.
Yeah, right, okay. So, but I was not expecting this at all. I was like, okay, this is just going to get pretty stoned and just walk around.
Well, but also you were projecting your own state to everybody else. So he was like, so our friend went to get in his car to drive to his friend's house, who was also very stoned about the stoned as I was. And he was like, we have to stop him. We have to go back after him because he's going to get in his car and drive. And it was like, no, he's fine. Like, if he's at the level that I am, which I assume he more or less was,
yeah.
like, he's maybe a bit too stoned to drive, but more or less fine.
Yeah,
he's
yeah.
not like you are. And being able to, you weren't able to disentangle, like, how you were feeling from
yeah.
how the whole world basically was. Like,
yeah.
the world is stoned, or at least the people you're with are also equally.
Maybe this is a problem that rad libs have.
What?
They can't disentangle how they're feeling from how...
Well, no. But like,
aren't you outraged?
No, I'm not. That is literally... A definition is the one I prefer of psychosis. You can't tell the difference between the way you feel and the
yeah.
way the world is.
Yeah,
yeah.
No, and I think I could still realize that that was, that it shouldn't be like that.
Yeah, so intellectually,
so,
that's
so
frustrating.
So I was still had enough of a foot in reality.
Right.
So it wasn't
but you were
like,
having niggling
like,
doubts that
but
you
it wasn't
quiet.
Like acid where,
yeah.
like, where you can't, you really
yeah, you
can't
have no
tell.
Idea what's really
so it's like that thing where people who get, right. They get a certain part of their brain damaged, then like they get this thing where they're convinced
that's you
that
made
everyone,
your brain's damaged now.
Well, I mean, drugs kind of do that temporarily, but they get this thing where if a certain part of their lobe gets damaged, they're convinced that everyone around them is like an imposter. Because they've
yeah.
lost the, it's like capacity
it's
where like you look yeah. at someone's face and it coheres into like, oh, this is the face of a person I recognize. So and they see all the features correctly, like they
yeah
they recognize that this person looks like you
oh,
know their
God,
sister
yeah.
or their
so
wife or
I've had some very
but
bad
it doesn't
loneliest.
It's like
yeah.
off somehow.
I've had some bad
it's
mushroom
damage.
Trips
yeah.
which
yeah.
I believed I had died. I was certain I was 18. No, I was 17. Last day of school, took a bunch of mushrooms, which were legal at the time, and just...
So psychedelic mushrooms or just more mushrooms?
Oh, just champignon de Paris in my salad. No, like...
And that was so good, you thought you died.
Yeah, yeah. This salad is so bad, I had thought I had died. No, like, ate psychedelic mushrooms and just genuinely, like, was crying my eyes out, trying to call, I think, my parents to try to be like, I'm dying. Help me.
Oh, no.
And my friends had to keep
oh,
taking
no.
like this clunky huge mobile phone away from me and just being like no, and then like these tissues flying everywhere, which were tissues that I'd been crying in so much that it and then finally like I things calmed down a little bit and walked out of the woods and it was very bright out and I was like, oh, so I'm dead and this is like heaven now and we're walking. And we took the metro and it
were
took all the way huh?
Were you upset?
I was upset, yeah, yeah, yeah. And my girlfriend at the time, I had to like go through the school yearbook to like check that I thought thing her photo would be missing because I was dead. Anyway, some confused thing. And she was there and I was like, and this
like
was at a pool
watcher.
Hall that we went to and it was like gone on the metro. And it was like an hour later until I realized, holy shit, I'm not dead. This is actually real and everything's fine. And then I started crying again. I'm like, oh God, that's okay.
Wait, so you thought you were in heaven and heaven just looked like, you know,
taking
the metro.
But very bright. Like it was
right.
a bit faded out. But
you didn't say anything about heaven. Where did you think you were?
No, I was still where I lived. I was in Brussels, and it was.
But
you were just dead. Oh, you were just a ghost.
Did you think?
Yeah, I was dead.
Purgatory,
well, I was just in some facsimile of the real world, but
oh,
which
right.
was post life.
Oh wow.
Oh, I think that's in a.
Post
I think
life.
A
yeah, it's like it's a euphemism for death. They're like, so they're now post life.
I think there's
like
a. Do you have you read Will Self?
Yeah,
there's a Will Self short story about
this.
Dead
place, which is just like the. It's just life all the way down.
Yeah, well, the Will Self story is like it's like, oh, when people in England die, they actually just go to this shitty part of England. Like.
Yeah, but that's Will Self who's a cunt.
He's
the most sneery, condescending,
still a good
like,
writer.
Liberal type, still a good writer, but
yeah.
just
absolutely
most.
Awesome.
You
know,
he's
even a liberal.
He's brought in as a political commentator because
Brexit.
He has a. Yeah, well, yeah, you can
yeah.
imagine like
his take on Brexit is one of the worst ones.
Well, just the most anti-working class, anti-popular kind of sense. Right, you know, right, just right. People are fucked. People are disgusting and stupid, and I'm just the best.
Yeah.
Know?
Cool.
Yeah.
Can we start reading them now?
Yeah, yeah.
We just found out Morrissey did another bad thing again.
Yeah, I know, but he's...
I love it when they just... I love when they do what they do.
I tolerate Morrissey because it's like, it's kind of... He's a musician, I don't care, but he, because he's a writer and he gets invited onto like panel, like political panel shows.
No,
you're like,
but
oh, what are you
doing
there?
I think they should invite Morrissey on the panel
show.
Every
time.
Instead of just saying just like two nice things and then one really racist thing, you're having to measure out like the weight. It's like, what is this idiosyncratic person?
Yeah. Every time he talks about politics, I like his music more. Because it just reminds me that he is a great artist. He doesn't have to justify his political choices.
Absolutely.
He can say whatever he likes.
And he does.
And he does.
Which is rooted in nothing. It's, he's one of those people who seems to have very, very, very emotional opinions without actually having them strongly.
Like, which fits in with the music.
Boomer.
Very, very self-pitying.
Yeah.
But also quite a thin self-pity. Because there's nothing really wrong.
Well, and emotions can fluctuate, and there's no like coherent structure to, you know, what your thought of, you know, for example, whatever being a bit fey and well, maybe being tolerant and open to the world at the same time as being like kind of racist, you know, and it's like,
and then
there's no coherent structure
all over the place politically.
Yeah.
Too.
Yeah.
Or like, God, what was he saying?
I know he's super pro. He wore like the pin of some far right pro Brexit party, and like people got mad at him for that.
I love how he's so dumb.
Oh, like England First or something? Or the,
Britain First.
Yeah, Britain First.
Britain
yeah,
first.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah,
that
yeah,
was
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
Oh god.
Yeah, yeah, which are like really, like really kind of, I don't know, neo fascists are almost there.
I love it. No,
well, he also says like.
Back to the point when it's like. No, I mean, because it'll force us to stop exaggerating, right? You know, when, like, a pop star actually does do something pretty awful.
Yeah.
You know, there was, like, a thing where,
I think
Eric Clapton
that...
just, like, shot off with a bunch of N-words.
Oh, yeah. But,
and, like, that was just normal.
Really?
In the 70s? Yeah.
I mean,
we've had some Clapton on in the car, because... convertible driving down the
freeway.
Right. Had to do that, right? Yeah. And he's like, oh, Eric Clapton, what a piece of shit. And he wasn't even a bit aware of that.
I didn't even know
that.
Yeah.
Oh, he just is definitely a piece of shit. And the music's boring.
Awful.
Ever,
and then like...
You're the band Anal
so,
Pun?
Like, yeah.
Yeah, they had a song called... It was like addressed to Eric Clapton and the song title was like, your kid killed himself because your records suck. It was...
But, like,
that is a strong title.
That was a problematic artist. Not fucking Taylor Swift, for fuck's sake.
Right,
Who, Clapton?
Yes.
Or Anal Pun.
I mean,
The song, Layla was about an underage... No. What am I thinking of here?
Every song about a woman written before like 1990, you can assume is written about an underage woman.
That is a very good rule of thumb.
Except for I don't know, Jesse's mom was written later. Yeah, unless the song is specifically about a MILF or some such, you can assume that
she's
underage.
Unless it's like Stacey's mom or something.
Yeah. And Stacey's mom is probably like 30 or whatever.
Yeah, it's like the MILF, like porn category of MILF, where it's just someone like over 25.
But that has turned into a lot of pop songs. There's
no
MILF genre of pop songs.
But maybe
there
it's
should
maybe.
Oh no, wait, is that just what Leonard Cohen is?
Hot for Teacher also.
Hot
for
Teacher. Yeah, we can say that.
I mean, it's funny, but that doesn't work. Leonard Cohen is obviously not MILF genre.
Leonard Cohen 100% went after 45-year-old women who like painted pictures of genocide. That man liked age-appropriate women. He might have also not other women, but he's definitely not someone who probably ran away from a 45-year-old.
Age inappropriate for a rock star.
Yeah.
You need to
it's like he was actually when they were 45.
Maybe,
like
in some distant future, people will look back and listen to like whatever 70s rock and be like, whoa, those guys really liked their daughters, didn't they?
Pretty wholesome.
Pretty wholesome. Man. This is wholesome stuff.
It is kind of sad that like everything is so explicit now. And I don't mean in a moralist way, I mean like in an aesthetic way.
No, yeah,
like,
there's no...
like there's no subtlety, yeah. And people used to really have to dance around shit,
yeah.
Which is funny.
Yeah, well, constrained art is often better art.
Yeah.
But even just sexual pleasure, which is like has a tension and a release. There's no tension, you're like fucking in the ass. Yeah. It's like, oh, okay, well, we're just there now, aren't
right,
we?
Right.
I think it's probably because people don't, the audience not getting it is way worse than kind of patronizing to your audience,
right? Yeah.
So you can't ever make them work and then not get it. Right. You have to instead say, yeah, you have to be explicit.
This is why Adorno was wrong. Adorno had that whole part in Dialectic of Enlightenment about like the entertainment industry and how it's all like, it all substitutes, simulacra for the real thing, and he had that whole passage about the instead of like showing the breasts, the television show us like the outline of the breasts in the sweater, and I'm like, no, just wait like 50 years, and they'll be showing the breasts.
We've got a problem actually that every single recording we've done, and this is maybe the sixth or seventh over the course of a couple of less than 7 days, has a mention of Adorno at least once in every single one, and this is a problem.
What? I mean. If it comes up organically, it's fine.
Yeah, no, we're just going to have to now.
Someone's been asking us to
do an episode on Adorno, and we're like, I don't want to have to fucking read Adorno and have something to say. I don't feel like doing that. But someone keeps nagging us about this. And now, this is just
grist of Adorno supercut.
Yeah,
yes.
Adorno supercut.
Yes.
Okay, settled.
It wouldn't really hang together in an episode.
You want a fucking Adorno episode here? Here's some people mentioning Adorno
just
and not really
stuff on the cutting room floor. Yeah, that just stays together.
It's like that supercut of just Trump saying China, like
right.
Shit,
yeah.
It's soothing after a while.
But it's China. Adorno.
Oops, got a little sidetracked there. Let's round this off by going back to our discussion at the University of California, Irvine, where we'll try to put a bow on this stuff about mental health and wellness. First, Catherine Liu. Then to close us off, George and Thomas Williams discuss what the drive is behind the capitalist focus on mental health. And George suggests that we maybe think about it in terms of rationalization.
I really feel like the institutionalized wellness regimes are the Taylorist disciplining of the people of the gig economy, the gig economy worker. So wellness as a way of optimizing and motivating workers' potentiality is a full-on managerial attempt to produce more, to extract more labor out of precarious and gig workers, especially young ones. And it's obviously addressing real serious mental health, public health crises, manifestations. But I feel like with ideology critique, people in the olden days used to say, well, what do you have to do about this? Well, you're so negative. Like, what can happen? Like, that's just so dark. And I do think that actual solidarity and politically robust forms of intersubjectivity are the only ways in which we can overcome this kind of the mental health crisis of depression, of atomization, and its corporate managerial techno-solutionism that is suggested as the cure.
You quote the WHO report, and there's some interesting lines in there. One is mental capital.
Yeah.
So good mental health allows for cognitive and emotional flexibility, which are the basis for social skills and resilience in the face of stress. This mental capital is vitally important for the healthy functioning families, communities, and societies. There's a copy of first volume of Capital out on the table there. So as far as I can remember, Marx doesn't use the phrase mental capital. No. What do they mean? Is it just purely mental states are an instrumental like resource of productivity?
I think so. Yeah. The next lines that are going to follow what you said says that mental health is an important economic factor. The shift from a manufacturing to a knowledge society emphasizes even more the importance of mental health for sustaining productivity. So good population mental health contributes to economic productivity and prosperity, making it crucial for economic growth. So there is actually obviously like no interest in mental health beyond,
for its own sake.
Like beyond, yeah, for its own sake, or for like the pursuit of, to kind of go back to minimalia where we start with, the kind of pursuit of like the good life, all right, or the right. That people have a life which is in any way set, you know, the idea that we have a life which is in any way separate from our economic activity is obviously something
yeah,
that we know we don't anymore, right? But it's.
But at least in the days of the high bourgeoisie, they believed that there was an aesthetic education that should be protected from the marketplace. And now nobody believes that. And even the highest bourgeois capitalist doesn't believe
that. I mean, I suppose it would be, again, naive to believe something like the WHO would prioritize our health over productivity. But I suppose maybe before I read this thing, I was not necessarily expecting quite so terrifying language. So really, that it's so like blunt and clear. Like this isn't something that's even. It's not like a secondary thing.
Yeah.
This is like what they when they're thinking about the importance of people's mental health. This is the only thing that they're interested in. The only thing.
I think it's important to economic growth.
Yeah.
That's the model. It's important growth because. We could just have economic stagnation.
Capital value and expansion, right? I mean, this is it seems to understand that very like very well in a way that again is shouldn't be surprising, but
I think
at least still kind of seems.
The treatment of economic growth is something as something that needs to be the boundaries of which need to be shaped. Right.
Yeah.
To in the lightest sense possible with minimal disturbance.
Yeah.
So it's about minimizing disturbance, minimizing risk, so that economic growth might continue, in the hope that the genie is out of the bottle, that the animal spirits kind of take care of themselves.
Yeah.
Because there's no planning faculty, and this is the thing about presentism as well.
Yeah.
Both in terms of your own self not being able to make plans because you don't know what job you're going to have next year, but also in the sense that that elites aren't able to. Take on planning and actually try to shape the future, even in very capitalist terms, are unable to shape the future and unable to shape the economy in such a way as to stimulate growth. It's just about making sure that there's fewer encumbrances, like, for example, someone having mental illness and not being able to contribute. So
it's papering over the cracks and pretending the crises aren't happening.
I think Weber's really useful here. This idea of rationalization, which I don't hear as much anymore, but I think it just fits so well. The instrumentalization, the quantification, there is some end which mental states in general are being utilized to get towards, which is a productive output one. But there's no real assessment of whether this is a good thing or not. Mm. And I think it does this is the logic of the way that we're increasingly dealing with mental states, and it even touches on the attempts to get pleasure through going to this dispensary that we were at. It was a completely rationalized process. I think that's is a good way to describe it, because it does have an internal logic. It's not completely arbitrary, and it's not completely it's quite shocking maybe when you read it for the first time, but you can see you can see where they're coming from.
Absolutely.
That's not what I'm saying.
Yeah.
But it really is about optimization
of
the human state.
All right, that's it for part two. In part three, we delve into the new class structure that has given birth to the Californian Ideology 2.0 and how this plays out in terms of cities and suburbs today. As a provocation, consider whether these developments we're discussing actually represent the end of the American dream. Or maybe even further, it's an American nightmare, one that's coming to you soon. Show business kids make-